Chapter 2, Compatibilism and Complementarism. The fact, regardless of context, is not evil. It is mere terrible actuality. It is the attitude to the fact that has a moral or immoral nature. Jordan Peterson. A woman named Joanna lives in my neighborhood. She is about 90 years old. I know from past interactions with her that she is a kind old lady who believes in God and lives a very religious life. I passed by her house recently and thought about those characteristics. The thought then popped into my mind. Isn't the same kind of nice old lady living in Afghanistan somewhere? Afghanistan itself is somewhat of an arbitrary designation, but one can read Khaled Hosseini's now classic book, The Kite Runner, to gain perspective on what it's like to live in that specific war-torn country, post 9/11. But even intuitively, we can know that there's a handful of nice old ladies in neighborhoods across the world. They may believe strongly in Allah or Brahman, both translated as God in Arabic and Sanskrit, respectively, or in no higher being at all, although less likely statistically. If true, then one must reconcile this fact with one's own beliefs. Do others have to hold the same truth as me to be good? If not, how accurate is my truth? Are the things we hold most dearly to be true, that differ from others' beliefs, mutually incompatible with those other beliefs? Before that question can be adequately approached, we need to zoom out and look at how exactly we find truth. Science and progress. Progress is a positive thing. As Noam Chomsky pointed out, the United States treated women and racial minorities as second-class citizens, by law, less than a century ago. It is certainly a step in the right direction that we no longer live in that reality in the States. And yet, America's original sin, that of slavery, still reverberates through our national psyche, especially as concerns race relations. And how could it not? Hundreds of years of the slave trade will naturally have long-lasting consequences. Hopefully, we will continue to see progress toward true equality and the moving away from the prejudices of the past. Sam Harris holds the hope that in the future, one's race will matter as much as one's eye color or hair color. That is to say, that it won't, and that race designation becomes completely arbitrary. 2020 didn't seem to point us in that direction, as the George Floyd murder led to exasperated battles of racial tension. The police officer who kneeled on Floyd's neck for 9 minutes, Derek Chauvin, was recently convicted for the murder. One can only hope that this brings healing, as justice was carried out, instead of only representing a temporary pause in strained racial relations. Albert Einstein was offered the presidency of Israel in 1952. But declined. His reasoning was that he was too naive in politics. He also gave further justification for continuing his scientific work instead, saying, "Equations are more important to me because politics is for the present, but an equation is something for eternity." This response from Einstein to an offer of great power shows two things about the physicist. He had a notion of eternity and the everlasting, and was humble as regarded his own capabilities, in this case, as a politician. Biographer Walter Isaacson wrote much of Einstein's humility in Einstein, His Life and Universe, 2007. That humility, Isaacson argued, stemmed from Einstein's ability to see that he could not possibly know enough to claim a firm grasp on underlying reality. And this from inarguably one of the smartest humans to ever live. Einstein was not above calling himself naive in certain areas of knowledge slash expertise, and even in his area of expertise, physics, he acknowledged where his understanding was lacking, as Walter Isaacson details. Einstein recognized this in the slightly odd title he gave to the paper, which he submitted on March 17, 1905, to the Annalen der Physik. On a heuristic point of view concerning the production and transformation of light. Heuristic, it means a hypothesis that serves as a guide and gives direction in solving a problem, but is not considered proven. From this first sentence he ever published about quantum theory until his last such sentence, which came in a paper exactly 50 years later, just before he died, Einstein regarded the concept of the quanta and all of its unsettling implications as heuristic at best, provisional and incomplete, and not fully compatible with his own intimations of underlying reality. So Einstein dealt with complex issues, in this case light quanta, are they particles or waves, with humility. He did this by neither allowing cognitive dissonance to cloud his judgment, nor allowing what seemed to be the case to overthrow everything else he knew about light. The man whose groundbreaking theories by necessity went against the status quo also practiced lifelong intellectual humility. This was true even when such humility seemed unfruitful. In a letter he wrote near the end of his life to his dear friend Michel Besseau, after quantum mechanics had been accepted by almost every living physicist, Einstein would later lament, "All these 50 years of pondering have not brought me any closer to answering the question, what are light quanta?" Quantum theory, and more specifically quantum mechanics, were new elements in the scientific world of Einstein's time, and ones that he tirelessly grappled with. The uncertainty of quanta, exemplified in Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, did not fit into Einstein's idea of a neat, rule-bound universe. Again, from Isaacson's biography, he conceded without apology that his success using tensor calculus to come up with the equations of general relativity had converted him to a faith in a mathematical approach, one that emphasized the simplicity and elegance of equations more than the role of experience. The fact that this method paid off in general relativity, he said, justifies us in believing that nature is the realization of the simplest conceivable mathematical ideas. That is an elegant and almost astonishingly interesting creed. It echoed the great Isaac Newton's declaration in Book 3 of the Principia, "Nature is pleased with simplicity." But Einstein offered no proof of this creed, one that seems belied by modern particle physics. Nor did he ever fully explain what exactly he meant by mathematical simplicity. Instead, he merely asserted his deep intuition that this is the way God would make the universe. "I am convinced that we can discover by means of purely mathematical constructions the concepts and the laws connecting them with each other," he claimed. Some may be surprised to read that Einstein was hypothesizing on the type of universe God would make. If Richard Dawkins is to be believed on the question of Einstein's belief system, then Einstein was not theistic at all, but rather used religious terminology only symbolically. As Dawkins' The God Delusion has it, there is every reason to think that famous Einsteinisms like "God is subtle, but he is not malicious," or "He does not play dice," or "Did God have a choice in creating the universe?" are pantheistic, not deistic, and certainly not theistic. "God does not play dice" should be translated as, "Randomness does not lie at the heart of all things." "Did God have a choice in creating the universe?" means, "Could the universe have begun in any other way?" Einstein was using God in a purely metaphorical, poetic sense. If Dawkins is correct about Einstein's religious beliefs, namely that he didn't have them and was only speaking poetically when he addressed God, then perhaps the biographer Isaacson was writing irresponsibly when he insinuated that Einstein considered God's creation of the universe. After all, when asked by the Archbishop of Canterbury about what ramifications Einstein's theory of relativity had on religion, Einstein replied, "None. Relativity is a purely scientific matter and has nothing to do with religion." Similarly, when Einstein was asked by the interviewer George Sylvester Viereck if he believed in immortality, he replied, "No, and one life is enough for me." However, when asked directly if science and religion conflict, Einstein answered with a resounding no. He did add the caveat, It depends, of course, on your religious views. At a dinner party, a guest once asked if Einstein were religious. Einstein replied, "Yes, you can call it that. Try and penetrate with our limited means the secrets of nature, and you will find that, behind the discernible laws and connections, there remains something subtle, intangible, and inexplicable. Veneration for this force beyond anything that we can comprehend is my religion. To that extent, I am, in fact, religious." Einstein later repeated this sentiment in a more formal written piece titled, What I Believe. It concluded with the following passage. "The most beautiful emotion we can experience is the mysterious. It is the fundamental emotion that stands at the cradle of all true art and science. He to whom this emotion is a stranger, who can no longer wonder and stand rapt in awe, is as good as dead, a snuffed out candle. To sense that behind anything that can be experienced, there is something that our minds cannot grasp, whose beauty and sublimity reaches us only indirectly. This is religiousness. In this sense, and in this sense only, I am a devoutly religious man." While the above official credo of Einstein may agree with Dawkins' analysis to an extent, it also has a strong ring of criticism to it for those like Dawkins who are sure that there is no God. Einstein venerated the mysterious, and with those who rejected the mystery amongst reality, he did not consider himself intellectual bedfellows. Indeed, he hated being tied into that group. "There are people who say there is no God," he would tell a friend, "but what makes me really angry is that they quote me for support of such views." He would also say, "What separates me from most so-called atheists is a feeling of utter humility toward the unattainable secrets of the harmony of the cosmos." And wrote in a letter that, "The fanatical atheists are like slaves who are still feeling the weight of their chains, which they have thrown off after a hard struggle. They are creatures who, in their grudge against traditional religion, as the opium of the masses, cannot hear the music of the spheres." So whereas Einstein was not a devoutly religious man in the traditional sense, saying, "I cannot conceive of a personal God who would directly influence the actions of individuals, or would sit in judgment on creatures of his own creation," he was also profoundly curious about who God might be. He even talked highly of Jesus. "As a child, I received instruction both in the Bible and in the Talmud. I am a Jew, but I am enthralled by the luminous figure of the Nazarene." So Einstein's religious and metaphysical beliefs were nuanced, at least. They are not the black and white picture that Dawkins would like to portray. It is important to read or hear directly from great minds such as Einstein's for their full take on important issues. Propagandists will aim to paint such minds as one-dimensional and often on board with the propagandist's agenda. This has happened so often with Einstein that Isaacson felt the need to dedicate a whole chapter to Einstein's God. Entire books have been written with titles such as Einstein and Religion, and the man himself felt the need to create an official What I Believe credo. Einstein expressed a type of faith in an orderly universe, often to the chagrin of his scientific peers working in quantum mechanics, and said that the eternal mystery of the world is its comprehensibility. The fact that it is comprehensible is a miracle. Again, he felt the need to distance himself from those in his day and those who would come later, who might use his work for something other than what he intended. "Well, a priori, one should expect a chaotic world, which cannot be grasped by the mind in any way. There lies the weakness of positivists and professional atheists." To Isaacson, it is obvious that Einstein was neither. In addition to analyzing Einstein's personal belief system, Dawkins takes on our whole reality in the opening chapter of The God Delusion. He cites science fiction, of all things, to make his initial point. Science fiction authors such as Daniel F. Galou in Counterfeit World have even suggested, and I cannot think how to disprove it, that we live in a computer simulation set up by some vastly superior civilization. But these simulators themselves would have to come from somewhere. The laws of probability forbid all notions of their spontaneously appearing without simpler antecedents. They probably owe their existence to a, perhaps unfamiliar, version of Darwinian evolution, some sort of cumulatively ratcheting crane as opposed to skyhook, to use Daniel Dennett's terminology. Natural selection is the champion crane of all time. We may well live in a computer simulation, Dawkins grants. What he cannot stand for is the possibility that such a simulation could be in line with traditional religious thinking, that God created the universe and we as his creation play out his plan. Instead, Dawkins cites the laws of probability to conclude that if we are in a simulation, it is being run by some superior being with their own form of Darwinian evolution. Granted, Dawkins probably was referring to evolution as we generally now understand it, but it is still notable that he cites Darwin when referring to this hypothetical alien species. Why thinkers like Dawkins are chained to the scientific method and Darwinian evolution, even in purely hypothetical scenarios, will be analyzed in Chapter 4. Unfortunately, Dawkins' certain dismissal of theism in regards to these topics is in direct contrast to Einstein's humility. How does Dawkins know that reality itself is bound by our current scientific understanding, when so much of reality is yet to be understood? After all, that which is unknown is wholly mysterious, until it is somewhat known, and continues along a gradient of mystery until it is completely known and made non-mysterious. The question then becomes, how much do we as limited, sense-dependent humans currently know? How much are we capable of knowing? Relevant here is the perspective of 17th century professor Gian Battista Vico, as described by Karen Armstrong. Gian Battista Vico, 1668-1744, professor of rhetoric at the University of Naples, argued that the historical method was as reliable as the scientific, but rested on a different intellectual foundation. Mathematics, Vico argued, was essentially a game that had been devised and controlled by human beings. If you apply the mathematical method to material that was separated from the human intellect, to cosmology, for instance, there was not the same fit. Because nature operated independently of us, we could not understand it as intimately as something that we had created ourselves. But we could know history in this way, because our civilizations were human artifacts. The scientific method taught the observer to be detached from what he was investigating because it was essential to science that the result of an experiment be the same, whoever performed it. Objective truth aspires to be independent of historical context and is assumed to be the same in any period or culture. Such an approach tends to canonize the present, so that we project what we believe and find credible back onto the past or onto a civilization whose symbols and presuppositions might be different from our own. Vico referred to this uncritical assessment of alien societies and remote historical periods as the conceit of scholars or rulers. It is another property of the human mind that wherever men can form no idea of distant or unknown things, they judge them by what is familiar and at hand. We know that humans cannot be 100% objective, and that we use different lenses for different modes of inquiry. Armstrong summarizes Vico's point with the following. Vico had put his finger on an important point. The scientific method has dealt brilliantly with objects, but is less cogent when applied to people or the arts. It is not competent to assess religion, which is inseparable from the complex human beings who practice it, and, like the arts, cultivates a perception based on imagination and empathy. A scientist will first form a theory and then seek to prove it experimentally. Religion works the other way around, and its insights come from practical experience. As a reminder, the purpose of this book is to write about God's existence. Such a focus is not specific to one theological bent or tradition. Rather, the helpful language is more philosophical than theological. Vico's comments on language use and the purpose of different language types is therefore applicable here. Jordan Peterson, while analyzing Alexander Solzhenitsyn's classic memoir on the Soviet camps, makes it a similar distinction of language, albeit with a different type of dichotomy. The evidence is intolerable. So much worse for the evidence. The hero, the savior, is metaphorical, or a narrative description of the pattern by which the existence of anomalous information is accepted, mined for significance, and incorporated into the body of cultural adaptation. The devil, incarnation of evil, is embodiment and procedure, episode and word, of the tendency that denies rather than accepts. Embodiment of the process that consciously inhibits life and its developments and brings to a halt the spirit's revolutionary process of adaptation. Cognitive dissonance either goes the spirit's way or the devil's. We either accept evidence and adapt accordingly, or reject it and stay stuck in old modes of thought. We know, for instance, that many of the scientific facts of 100 years ago are laughable to us now. Many of our current facts will be laughable 100 years from now. Church and tradition. Don't lose the faith. Christians especially will say this, with books like Sticky Faith acting as guidebooks on how exactly to keep young people from losing their faith. College, it seems, is a common time for such a thing to happen. To some, not losing the faith equates to never questioning. To others, it means honestly assessing the world around them, considering scientific findings and different arguments, cutting through cognitive dissonance and all the discomfort that comes with that process, and holding everything with intellectual humility, including the occasional denial of what was once thought to be true. The latter could also be called reintegration of faith. Religion, in one aspect, is a primitive stating of laws that for the most part still hold true. Rules against killing and against taking someone else's wife are universals in cultures throughout history. When these rules were stated, they were stated in such a way that they could be easily understood and followed by their contemporary listeners. Their structure was practical. Today, statistics, polls, and the annals of history tell us that we're better off if we all get along. Murder and sleeping with someone else's spouse are top candidates for strife, now as ever. These maxims still hold true. For Jews and Christians, the book of Genesis provides truth in symbols. Man started out vegetarian. In the primordial Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were told to eat the fruit of the trees, all except one. After the fall, man became carnivorous. Such a timeline is in line with more recently developed anthropological theory that man was first vegetarian, then carnivorous. We became carnivorous around the time that our brains started growing rapidly. Brains then only limited in growth by the size of the female birth canal. In Genesis, God told Eve, "You shall have pain in childbirth." This could be interpreted to mean, men now have unlimited capacity for knowledge. There will be pain in giving birth because their brains will be very large. Genesis, like other ancient texts, contains much deeper truths than what is seen at a first reading. If the original author of Genesis 1 could see his work, clearly written and structured as a poem, being read and interpreted today as literal fact, his response might very well be something like, "Fools, did I not spell it out grammatically and structurally? My work is grand, and you simplify to the point of non-meaning. You sacrifice deep truth on the altar of literality, as if that is all you are capable of understanding." In episode 205 of his Making Sense podcast, Sam Harris cites divorce and being born out of wedlock as two factors which most greatly harm the future economic opportunities of children. His guest, the economist Daniel Markovitz, agrees, saying about the relevant data, "If you didn't look at them again, you wouldn't think they were real." Later in the podcast, Harris and Markovitz discuss the modern possibilities for breaking up the immense wealth share of the ultra-wealthy. Unfair rent prices are mentioned as one source of the inequality gap. Someone familiar with the Hebrew Bible can't help but hear echoes of the Hebrew prophets in such pronouncements. Why does Sam Harris, perhaps unknowingly, echo prophets? For one, we are deeply set in the Judeo-Christian ethic in the West. As has often been said of culture, it is the water we swim in. Second, the Bible and other religious texts describe the deeper aspects of the human condition, a condition that we have yet to completely overcome. So being human, for all else that has changed through time, still echoes ancient antecedents. The major, time-tested, religious texts represent truths that still hold today, even if they were expressed in ways that seem primitive to us now. When these texts were written, the authors didn't have nearly as much access to information as we do now. That is why it is appropriate for us to speak of ancient texts as metaphorical. The original contexts were literal to their hearers in that they represented the hearer's own time, place, and culture. These contexts and the prescriptions that follow can seem archaic and unenlightened to us now, and how could they not if we have progressed at all? But we should be able to differentiate between time-bound context and independent of time truths. We can rightfully abandon the context-dependent bits, where man was insulated by his experience of a Hobbesian, nasty, brutish, and short life, while picking out the bits of more universal human truth. We put ourselves in grave danger if we throw the whole baby of ancient wisdom out with the bathwater of outdated ancient descriptions. We may not realize just how much of what makes us civil to one another and to ourselves is wrapped up in the former. Wisdom itself, to a large degree, is bound by the ability to do this in the various aspects of life, picking the baby out of the bathwater, the shell out of the nut, the diamond of truth out of the rough of human error. In this respect, Sam Harris lacks wisdom, calling our ancestors ignorant because they were far off from modern notions of objective reality. Actually, we stand on the shoulders of giants, as Newton said. We wouldn't be here physically or intellectually without our ancestors' inestimable contributions. Figure 1 on the following page outlines what such a giant may look like conceptually. Figure 1 is a large human figure made up of many smaller human figures. Some of these smaller figures are labeled from bottom to top chronologically: Confucius, Socrates, Buddha, Moses, Newton, and Einstein. Modern men are labeled, standing on the shoulders of this giant mass of previous men. The head of this large figure is mysterious, labeled God, in all and through all, theoretically. Mm-hmm.